In the last video, we looked at one-dimensional integrals. Now we're going to look at two-dimensional integrals and see what they're good for. So a two-dimensional integral is where the region that you're interested in is two-dimensional. Sometimes it's an area problem, sometimes it's a volume problem. In this case, we're going to look at the question of what is the population of Colorado. So the strategy is the exact same thing as in one-dimensional integral. The strategy is the whole is the sum of the parts. So we're going to break the state into small pieces. So how do we do that? We slice it vertically. Slice it vertically. And we're also going to slice it horizontally. Use a different color. And now we've broken the state of Colorado, which was conveniently rectangular shaped, into a bunch of little blocks. And then we say, all right, we need to figure out the population of each little block. And then if we can figure out the population of each little block, we add them all up and we'll get the population of the entire state. Of course, we only estimate the population of each piece. And when we estimate, we're going to make some errors. So we want to get more and more and more accurate. And the way we get more and more and more accurate is to chop things up finer and finer and finer and finer and take a limit. So let's see what that means mathematically. Mathematically, what we've got is a function. F of xy is the population density. Now, in one-dimensional integrals, the thing we were integrating was stuff per unit length. In this case, population density is population per unit area. You don't measure people per mile, you measure people per square mile. And so if you've got your big box here, and you've chopped it into a bunch of pieces, what we're going to do is we're going to say that the population of one box is approximately the density times the area of that box, right? Since the density is population per unit area, if you take the density and multiply it by the area, you get the population of the box. And of course, that's the same thing as f of xy times delta x times delta y. So the upshot is we have to somehow figure out how to get the population in the density in each box. Now, what that means is that in each box, we have to pick a point. Before we had the xi star to represent each little interval, now we're going to have a representative point for each box. So we use two indices to label the boxes. We're going to use a horizontal index. Let's call it I, goes from 1 all the way up to, say, n. And we're going to use a vertical index where j goes from 1 up to m. So in this case, I is, you know, n is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And m is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, because we've broken this up into an 8 by 6 grid. And we're going to label each box. So this box here is the 4, 3 box, because it's 4 across and 3 up. And so what we're going to do is we get that the total population is approximately the sum. Well, let's see. I has to go from 1 to n, and j has to go from 1 to m, and then we need f of some point times delta x times delta y. And the question is, what's that point? You need to have an x, you need to get to have a point. A point has the point you pick, whatever point you pick in here has an x coordinate, we'll call that xij star. It has a y coordinate, we'll call that yij star. And if you want an exact answer, you take a limit. The exact answer is the limit as n goes to infinity, and as m goes to infinity, you chop things up finer and finer and finer and finer of this sum. Yij star times delta x times delta y. Now, this was exactly the same procedure that we did for one-dimensional integrals. And so we call this a two-dimensional integral. We say that this is the integral. We use two integral signs to show that we're integrating over a two-dimensional region. And we write that, let's call the region R. In this case, the region R is the state of Colorado. The function of x and y, dx, dy. So that is what an integral is in two dimensions. If you had an integral in three dimensions, you would have to have a sum as I goes from 1 to n, as j goes from 1 to m, as k goes from 1 to l of x. Well, then you'd have to break things up to three-dimensional boxes. Two dimensions is enough for now. Now, this doesn't tell you how you actually go about computing the integral. In one dimension, we use the fundamental theorem of calculus to compute integrals. We found antiderivatives, and we evaluated it at the endpoint. That's not what an integral is, but it's how you compute an integral. In the next section, we're going to show how to compute integrals over two-dimensional regions by doing one variable at a time and using the fundamental theorem of calculus.